Shall I start? So FFI, this is a not a big discourse to FFI. What is it? How we can use it? And a couple of examples. And then we will go with VM. So this is an outline of this talk. Actually, what is FFI, how it's done, when do you need it, and for what you need it, why you, is there better alternatives, what are security concerns, and what we have up to date or current state of implementation of FFI in our in Squeak VM or VM for Faro and Squeak. So FFI stands for Foreign Function Interface, and it connects our language with foreign languages. Mainly, roughly speaking, it's almost every time, almost always about C, connected with C, because we have systems, most of the systems, most of operating system is implemented in C, and communicating with each is their parts communicating using C as base level. So how it's done? Dynamic libraries uses the standards is known as ABI, application binary interface, and this conventions for defining the entry points into external libraries to their functions, to the external symbols. So applications which use external library could find the addresses to these functions and use them. So if we can implement and follow these standards in our VM implementation, and if we can honor them, we can use the external libraries for our own purpose. And FFI actually is done exactly for that. So you can during runtime, you can load the dynamic library and dynamically call its functions and find its symbols. So that's simple as that. So when do you need it? Virtual machine is just minimal. Often it's not so especially for embedded systems. It don't provide you all the functionality you need, and for accessing some specific functionality which provides third party libraries, you need either to write plugin or use FFI. So here is where FFI, one of the ways how you can access the external functionality written in C or in another language and use it for your application. And yes, one of the questions, why don't write a plugin for VM? So good question, because in longer perspective, plugin is better because you can play better with security and with safety of your application. You can do more appropriate type checking and argument conversion between actual calls and your language building, but from another side is how much energy you want to put into that and how fast you can access the functionality you need. Because if you want to just build a prototype and check if this solution good enough for you, FFI is much better because you spend much less time for prototyping and from starting to using it is much less time span. And finally, one of the aspects I think is my own belief that statically generated code is what I mean by statically generated code is a compiled code which never changing during runtime. It counting last days on Earth, because with dynamically generated code you have much better can adapt to environments much better and much faster. So consider this when you're using FFI. Security. So it's never an ending rant about security. Is using FFI secure? Does it opens additional security holes comparing to another usages or another implementations? Well, my answer is that Smalltalk is open architecture, and originally there is little or no security. So if we want to address security in our language, first we have to deal with Smalltalk itself, and only then with things like FFI. And of course, I don't think that malicious code written which use FFI to make calls to external libraries, like to kernel, to hook into system and to steal something or to damage something, is anything worse than same malicious code which just using the Smalltalk and VM virtual machine capabilities. It's for me, it's almost same level. And of course, FFI is not tool for users, it's for developers. So my point is that we should let developers decide what is good for them, and let them decide if their application have enough good enough security. So from this perspective, FFI is just a tool. We should give it to people to use, and what they do, it depends. Existing implementation. So most old one is FFI plugin. It was originally only one FFI implementation for Squeak virtual machine, and recently we have an Alien and Native Boost implemented by me. Yes. So I will not stop about last two. I just give some basic overview on the first one. So here you see the method which using the FFI callout. It's a special syntax for calling the FFI, calling the external function using FFI. So what happens here that during parsing of this method, parser detects that you have a special pragma which stands for external call, and then it captures all the data inside this pragma and marks this method with primitive 120, which has primitive external call, and adds the information encoded information which he parsing in a callout specification into methods literal. So then when at runtime when you invoke this method, the primitive takes the information about callout, converts the arguments, making a call to external library function. And then when function returns, it converts in the return value and gives you back into gives the answer back to language. So here you see the the given method calls get environment variable A, which is a function in kernel 32.dll. It's a Windows function for Windows operating system, and it takes three arguments: char pointer, byte pointer, and ulong. It's a types of arguments, and answers the single value ulong. Yes. A good question, because the syntax for FFI callout are not following the usual syntax for pragmas. So it handled specifically by parser, not it's exceptional syntax, but it's historically it's done like that. So I think that it's because at the time when it was designed, there was no no common sense of the need, no common need for pragmas, and there was no well established standard in language for pragmas. So mainly the pragmas which used for or method annotations as currently some of one call it, it's a the code in this brackets, mainly they used for primitives, for marking methods with primitive and nothing else. Today we use pragmas or method annotations for much more, for many other different things, for annotating method with some specific information, but I think you know about this already. So it will be good to actually put an effort into this and make FFI callout to follow the standard. Okay, so in detail about this callout specification. So first keyword is denotes the call convention to use. It could be either API call or CD call. Then we have the function specification, function prototype. So if you know C, it's quite similar to what you use in C. So you specify in the return type, name of function, and in braces you have enumeration of argument types. Although in FFI spec, you could use either function name or function index. So there's some on some platforms you can actually identify the function not by name but an index. So it's like if you in external library you have the table functions, so you can invoke them by index. You can find them, look up and find them by index, not just by name. It makes no difference. I think that a symbolic name is always is preferable. It's much more better because index don't have the guarantee that at given index there will always be same function, especially if you use on different platforms or even different versions of same library, it can just move up or down randomly. So it's preferable, of course, to use name. And last keyword is module. It's actually the name of external library or path to it. So you can put the path to it or just name and let operating system look up for external library. Yes.
So, first, before we go on, is this only for Windows? Or I'm seeing all these Windows examples. Or is it working also on Linux and Mac?
It works on everywhere where you have FFI. Yes, it works for all major platforms.
Okay. How do you have install FFI?
How do you install?
Yeah.
Okay. So there is. I don't know if I missed that part. Ah, yes. So you see, this is the sourcequick.org/FFI. And you load, there are two packages, FFI pools and FFI kernel. Yes, there is, yeah.
And the plugin is already included in all VM.
It's quite easy to load it. Okay, call conventions. Mainly it's about x86 call conventions. So we have two variants, IP call and CD call. IP call is call convention, but you can read, of course, about calling convention on the given link, but I just give you the usual for basic understanding what is call convention. So call convention is how you pass arguments to the function and what is the stack discipline, what is the registers discipline, and how you obtain the return value. So call convention specifies that you should pass all the values or the arguments to function in on stack or part of arguments on stack, part of arguments in registers and things like that. So for our most used platform which is x86, IP call or std call is also known as Pascal call. It pushing arguments from right to left. Then after function call, after return, the curly, the function which is called, responsible for cleaning the stack. And this is the main difference comparing to cdecl, which is a standard C call convention used almost by every compiler by default, which lets the caller to clean the stack instead of curly. So this have own pros and cons. cdecl, which the main difference I think between this call convention is that With the call convention, you can use the variable argument function. So, because it's not because if you use functions with variable arguments, you can push any number of arguments on stack. And because caller responsible for cleaning the stack, it knows how much arguments were pushed, and therefore it knows how to clean the stack after making a call. With std call or ap call, this is not possible, so you always should push the same number of arguments as function requires. So with FFI, you have some basic types. Mainly is one-to-one correspondence to C basic types, and you can find them in external type, initialize atomic types. So mainly FFI provides converters between these types and corresponding Smalltalk objects, and anything else is just built on top of that. So special type is a pointer type. So if you see any of this basic type, if you put a star after this its name, it becomes a pointer. What a pointer is just a memory location, a pointer to the value which held in some memory slot. So with a pointer type, you can use instance of variable byte or variable word classes like byte array, word array, float array, or even your custom variable length class, and pass it as a argument into any pointer type, as into function which expects a pointer type argument. So when you do it, the pointer to first indexed slot of object, indexable field of object, is pushed on stack. And if you specify the return value this pointer type, you will get the pointer value as return. At return. Okay. There's also a complex types for supported by FFI. So if you need to use C structures, because many different libraries grouping the values into structures and provides the AP which works with them, you need to use them to pass as argument or as access its fields and fill them in FFI. So for defining the structure, you need to create a subclass of external structure, and then in this class, at class side, define the fields method, which describes every field in their order and type for each field. Once you define this method, the external structure having special hook, which automatically generates an accessor for this for the fields. So once you define fields in the field method, on instance side, you automatically obtain the accessor, automatically get an accessor to fields, and it and if you change the fields later, it will recompile correspondingly, regenerate these methods correspondingly. There's also a possibility to make external calls programmatically. So for this, you need to instantiate the external library function Then a few arguments with their types and everything you need. And then to invoke function, just use one of the invoke methods, which expects some arguments. Of course, depends how much you function, how much arguments your function expects. So that's mainly the basics about FFI. So example, I can show you how it works. This is a demo image with big fonts. So everyone can see it. So this is one of the examples which come with if you download the FFI package, FFI examples package, you can find some examples for different operating system and different libraries. So what we have here. Yeah, so okay. On this? Okay. Yeah. And this should close it. Okay. So here you see the FFI callout to get n function which located in system library. I am just a beginner with macOS. I never worked with macOS before, but you know, once you know the how things works, you know you can use it on any platform. You just need to know which library implements the functionality you need, and then you just use it. This is very simple. So let's do something. So this function retrieves the environment variable. Yes.
Does apt call work in Mac? I thought it was only with CDL.
It's mainly as far as I know, apt call is mainly a difference between apt call and std call is that there is some kind of convention of system libraries usually define the apt call as something different from usual call convention which you use in programs. So for instance, in Windows operating system, all system libraries using std call call convention, while if you use your own libraries, it use cdecl call convention. So but if you follow the documentation about function and documentation about library, you can always tell the which call convention you should use. As far as I know, for macOS there is no difference, but yeah. So here I invoke the this getN function and get a result which is actually the path environment variable, which answers the path string. I can show you same in console. It's a bit more than for SQVM, but I think it's because it's initialized differently, but it's the same. Yes, and things to come.
Excuse me, Igor.
Yes.
I want to come back to the example.
Yes.
So if I'm sending if I want to send a structure as a parameter, so I will change the char there, and what should I put? The name of the class that provides the structure definition?
Yes, yes. I can show you. So here you see the external structure subclass macrect. You can see its fields definition here. It's four variables with short type, which is a two byte wide integer. Yeah, we can try this. Try to call this, but I don't not sure if it will work, but we can try. Yeah, you see something is wrong here, and you have the external call failed, and it's explains could not coerce arguments, but of course you risk in much more when you do that, because you could crash the virtual machine if you call the function with wrong arguments. So
can you go back to the API call?
API call in slides?
No, there.
Yes. Yes. So you pass the pointer to macrect structure. It means that the instance of macrect is an external structure which holds the in memory. Actually, it just holds the buffer which filled with the values, and it's just passing the pointer to first field. So if you can see the external structure class inherits from handle, and handle used to be just simple byte array. So when you access in the external structure, it just fills or reads from the byte array, and when you use it as an argument in function, it just passing the pointer to this byte array. So does that answer your question?
Mm-hmm. So what is the API field? Take it. Another one. Take the one where we have two arguments. Yes. So what is this mac pix path?
This is another structure, you see.
Okay, that's another structure. Okay.
Yes. So it only one is just a pointer as it appears.
Moment the access are compiled, because one of I didn't know that one of the brands that I had is that I code the accessor, so each time I run my test or whatever, they are dirty, because sometimes I commit and it's dirty because someone comes. So
you mean the package gets dirty when you change the fields?
Okay, so I can remove them and it will be compiled.
It could be fixed in FFI package, I think, to mark these accessors with category which not included into your package. Yeah, let me show you. So you see all these methods generated automatically, but FFI placing them into accessing category. This means that it makes the package dirty, and I can show you actually.
And if I remove the accessor, it will be safe because it will be compiled automatically.
Yes, it should actually do this automatically. So you see, it's already dirty in my image. Here mark rect. So you see, these methods actually don't exist in original package. They are added when you load the package and it compiles them. But because the category is misplaced, it makes the package dirty. Mm-hmm. But this is easy to fix, and yeah, and we have to tell the maintainer to fix that. Okay, so more or tell or ask. Yeah, so you have more questions? Yeah, about more things to go in the CogVM. We might have the callbacks and threaded calls. So a couple words about callbacks. Callback is when you pass in the function as argument to another function. It means that when you call the external function, it then calls the function you provided as argument, which is callback, calls back. So that's why it calls. And threaded calls, it means that sometimes you don't want to stall the whole execution engine in virtual machine, for especially when you make blocking calls. So you can with threaded calls you can schedule or make a call to external function and continue running the interpreter in separate thread, in different thread. And when call completes, you take in the arguments and continue execution from in process which make a call. But I think more details, I hope about this Elliot can tell more. So that's mainly all about FFI. Yes.
If for the threaded calls, if I have the same problem for the script DevX, that some database library does not support asynchronous queries, so there's no way to avoid the whole locking the VM. So I was thinking if I could write a plugin that actually we have already done. So if I build my own plugin, VM plugin, is there a way that I can start a thread inside my function, and I mean in the plugin I can handle that, or there's no way from the BM point of view. But that I
well, you see, the problem is that you should. You should do this, do that for threaded call support. You have support this at two domains, at language side and VM side. So for language side, when you do the threaded call, you should suspend the process which made the call, violating other processes in Smalltalk processes to run. So you mean that you do the threaded call, you make a call in some native thread, and it's processing the call, and the main thread, the virtual machine thread, continues to run, and it has chance to implement to switch to another process, because the process which made the call is suspended for the time of processing the external call. Well, and another different processes could run. So this means that the main idea why we need this is to not stall the whole VM when you're making the blocking calls. Yes, it is possible to do in a plugin, but I think that there is missing API in VM to switch the process, because to signal that your process is should be suspended and things like that. So, but yes, if you go that way, it's possible to implement with little more effort. But I think in general, I think that. For FFI, it will be much more good to have this out of the box without making a plugin. Because as I told that, maybe in longer perspective, plugin are better because you are in much finer control what happens. But for example, with native boost, you are even more finer control on what happens, and you don't need to change VM, because it's always a problem that when you've written a plugin and you want to distribute your code, you have to ship the own custom VM, and for different people it's a political or security question. They don't trust you. They want to use a standard VM. They don't care about your hacks or whatever. So we as community should provide a way how we can deliver our custom hacks to users so they can try them out. And then they can decide if they want to use it or not. Yes?
Will it be free of memory that's
allocated by? Manually. So, usual pattern for any external resource, you registering the object which holds the pointer or reference to external resource, registering it in weak registry, and then when this object becomes a garbage, you making a direct call to some function which frees this resource. So
objects that are automatically converted, like car pointers, for example, I guess they're copied over.
No. You cannot guess. I mean, even if you've written C program, and even if you're using some external library, one library could give you a pointer to external resource and can tell, okay, you own this, so you can free it, or it can tell, okay, I am in charge, so when you need to free this resource, you have to call my some special function. So.
But I mean, with the car pointer, you probably never even get access to the actual car pointer that you get back, because it's copied to a variable byte, whatever object.
A car pointer.
Yeah, it's character pointer.
Strings. Yes. For strings, it's a bit easier because they are well known that null the pointer to string is null terminated string, so you can copy all the bytes which up to null, copy in separate region and then create the string object. You are on your own. You need to know what our function expects and what it returns. It's always like that.
So in the API call, you have to pass somehow which argument. You
it
can.
Depends what again. It depends from the library which you use. If library just gives you a pointer to string and tells nothing about it, so you can expect that. You don't need to deallocate it explicitly, but it depends from library which you use. Of course, if you have the source code to that library which you use, you can always check. But for closed source, you have to follow documentation. But it's always like that. So if you deal with C. In your life, you should know that you're doing the same, and it's not much different with FFI. It's the same because in C you don't have the automatic memory management or automatic resource management. So you have to ensure that when you no longer using the external resource, you have to free it in some way. And usually we do it using the finalization pattern. Yes?
So if I understood correctly from the previous question, in principle we don't get back basic types by copy.
You mean copy by value or?
Copy by value, yes. Everything is by reference.
For basic types, you actually get the values. You don't have a reference.
So maybe the question is in the cases where we have by copy transfer of data, we get the garbage collector just to free our side from the small talk side.
Yes, but if you again, you have to be careful. If you pass in the And one of the complications with threaded calls, if you pass a pointer to your object data, so like a byte array, yes, if you pass a pointer to it into external function, you have to be very careful because, for instance, a function expects that you pass a buffer with 100 bytes long, yes, and it writes something into that buffer. But you may pass the buffer with 50 bytes long, and as a result you have the corrupted object memory. So you have to be very careful when you do that.
Okay, so I just check. The coffee break is ready.